Happy Resurrection Sunday. What an honor to have you with us today, knowing that He is alive. We love you guys. We're going to celebrate the risen Savior, and it's going to be better because you're with us.
Oh, that's so good. Happy Easter. We love you guys so much, and we're so glad that you have tuned in today to be a part of this service. We believe that you're not going to be disappointed. You're going to leave better off than when you came.
This is a new day. I'm calling out the mighty hero. The forces that are for you are greater than any force that's trying to stop you.
And we believe today, God, that you will do what only you can do.
He calls you a barrier breaker, a prized possession. Resurrection of our Savior this morning. What a joy to have you with us on this Easter Sunday morning. We welcome all of you and just speak blessings over you. And wow, what a great time it is that we can come together and just, you know, really just remember what Jesus did. He paid the ultimate price. He gave his life. But boy, we can celebrate that He came out of the grave, that He's alive. And I love what, you know, he said, because I live, you can live also. And I love that, because that doesn't just mean, you know, you can have breath, but he meant you can have an abundant life, that we can have freedom, we can have victory. And that's what we celebrate every week here at Lakewood. But this Resurrection Sunday, we're going to celebrate it a little greater even. So thanks for coming out today. We love you guys. And so many watch online and listen live on SiriusXM, but we're going to have a great time. I think another thing about Easter to me is it's a time of new beginnings. You know, the old was gone. Jesus came up out of that grave. And I think it's a good reminder for all of us to, you know what, we need to leave some things in the past. How about leaving guilt in the past and leaving what somebody said in the past and leaving a disappointment in the past? Come on, this is a new day. It's a day of freedom. It's a day of blooming and blossoming. But I believe if we'll leave the wrong things there, that you'll come into a new season. Come on, Jesus, God raised Jesus from the dead. He can turn around anything that we're facing today. So let's be believers, not doubters. Coming into this Resurrection Sunday, just thanking God that we're gonna see His resurrection power in our own life. But honored to have you with us today. Make yourselves at home. We're gonna have a good time celebrating today.
Amen. Happy Resurrection Day. You look amazing. So glad that you are in the house of the Lord sharing this incredible day together. You know, Easter is just a time of new beginnings, like Joel was saying. It feels fresh. It feels new. It feels like God has just breathed His anointing on us afresh and anew today. So I just want to encourage you to just soak up everything God has for you today. You know, it's interesting. God speaks to us all in different ways, with different methods, different sentences, different parts of the service. But I know one thing. God wants to get a message to you today, and He wants you to know that He is with you. He will never forsake you. This day is all about you and me and what He did for us. Because of what He did for us, He saw us. So I love that so much. And I love the scripture this morning that I read in Matthew. And it was Matthew's account of Mary going to the tomb after Jesus had been buried. And she went with all kinds of spices and things to anoint His body. And you know, it's interesting because I think to myself, well, He was already dead, and what was going on? And I thought, well, Mary, you didn't know what to do. Have you ever been to that place? You just don't know what to do. So she thought, what can I do? I'll go to the tomb. I'll get His body ready. What can I do? And when she got there, He appeared to her in the form of an angel, and he said, Mary, Jesus isn't here. He's on His way to Galilee. He's already gone before you. And I thought, God, you're still doing that today. You're a living God. You go before us and make crooked places straight. God, you already made a way where there is no way. You're already where we're going. And you've made sure that we can get there. So I want to encourage you today. You may not know what to do. You may feel like Mary and go, what do I do? It feels like it's over. It's impossible. But Jesus is making a way for you. He's already going. He's already going to be where you're getting. He's already going to make sure the road is cleared for you. So today, relax in His presence. Be confident in His presence. Know that He is ahead of you, making a way, whatever is going on in your life. Amen. So let's enter His presence with thanksgiving and joy in our heart, knowing that we're not alone, that He'll never leave us or forsake us. Amen. Father, we thank You for this day. We thank You that we can come together as believers, Father, and that we can join our faith knowing that there is hope in every situation, knowing You are the God of all hope, and that's who we look to today. Our risen Savior, our risen Christ, who has made a way for us. We want You to know we love You today, and we stand before You with our hearts open, our arms open, and our eyes on You. Speak to us, Lord, as we glorify You with our praise. In Jesus' name, and everyone said, amen. Amen.
Your mercy's on you.
body was broken, your love poured out. You bled and you died for me there on that cross. You breathed your last as you were crucified. You gave it all for me. Hallelujah, what a Savior. Hallelujah, what a friend. Hallelujah, King forever. We thank you for the cross. Yeah.
We do thank you for the price that you paid. Lord, we know that you went to that grave, but you didn't stay there, that you came up for each one of us. And Lord, on this Resurrection Sunday, a couple thousand years later, we don't forget what you did and the price that you paid. And we're here to say thank you for redeeming us and restoring us and making a way that we could have an abundant and eternal life. And Lord, we are grateful. We praise you and we thank you today. And Lord, on this Resurrection Sunday, we say it publicly that you're our Lord, our God, and our Savior. Lord, make us and mold us into who you want us to be. I thank you that you're going before us right now, making the crooked places straight, opening right doors and closing wrong doors, that you're bringing the right people across our path and that you're weeding out those that should not be there. Lord, I thank you that we'll make decisions that honor you, that we will fulfill the destiny that you've laid out for each one of us. Lord, I thank you that as we're worshiping you this morning, that every force that's trying to stop us has been broken in the name of Jesus. Depression, anxiety, addiction, sicknesses, bad habits, trouble at work, at home, in our finances. Lord, I thank you that today is a breakthrough day. Lord, just like you raised Jesus from the dead, I thank you, Lord, that you're a supernatural God, that you're turning things around in the lives of your people today. And Lord, our eyes are upon you. Sometimes we don't see how it can work out, but Lord, our trust is in you. We know there's nothing too difficult for you. So Lord, we're gonna come back to a place of peace on this Resurrection Sunday, knowing that you're in control, that Lord, that you have good things in store for each one of us, that you will get us to where we're supposed to be. We love you and we trust you, Lord God. Father, I do lift up those that are fighting battles in their health. Some in the hospital, some don't feel well this today even. Lord, I thank you right now, Lord, that you're sending healing to all those that need it, restoring health back to your people. Lord, you gave your life for our sins and our sicknesses. We declare that by your stripes we are healed, Lord God, that healing is flowing into all those that need it. Lord, even when medicine cannot do it, Lord, we know you have the final say. So Lord, I speak healing, wholeness, strength, energy, vitality, that the tide would begin to turn in the health of your people in Jesus' name. And Lord, not just physically, but I lift up those that are in tough times, those that have gone through loss. Father, you said you're close to the brokenhearted. I ask, Father, that they'd feel your presence right now. Let them know that we're praying for them, that you would comfort them, give them that peace that only you can give. And Lord, even though it may look like the end to them, I think that you'll show them it's really a new beginning, that you're still in control. So I speak peace and strength and fresh vision and fresh anointing. Lord, I thank you that our latter days will be better than our former days, that weeping may endure for a night, but joy is coming in the morning. I thank you, Lord, for the joy that's on the way, the beauty for ashes, in Jesus' name. And Lord, we can look back in all of our lives and we can see your times of favor and blessing, goodness and mercy. We don't take that for granted. And Lord, we thank you in advance that 2024 will not be a get-by, make-it-through year, but it'll be a blessed, prosperous, favor-filled, abundant, productive year, that we are victors and never victims, in Jesus' name. And if you receive it, can you say amen today? So awesome to have you in the house of the Lord, celebrating what Jesus has done for us. And you know, one way we can release our faith is through our words. And Jesus came that we might live an abundant life. And I just prayed that, not a get-by year, but how about a blessed year? How about a favor-filled year? Well, I've learned in my own life, one thing, you know, you're prophesying your future by what you're saying. You can't talk defeat and see victory. And so every service, we like to take a moment to say what God says about us. So I'm gonna invite you all to join in like we always do. Are you ready? Say it like you mean it. I am blessed, prosperous, redeemed, forgiven, healthy, whole, talented, creative, confident, secure, disciplined, focused, prepared, qualified, motivated, valuable, free, determined, equipped, empowered, anointed, accepted, and approved. Not average, not mediocre. I am a child of the Most High God. I will become all I was created to be in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. I love that. Not average, not mediocre. I'm looking at children of the Most High God. Keep your shoulders back. Keep your heads held high. Not only to know who you are, but remember whose you are. God handpicked each one of us to be here for such a time as this. I say it, I said it, I think last week, but this comes up. Somebody needs what you have. Somebody needs your gifts. Somebody needs your smile. Somebody needs your love. You know, you are needed in this world, and without your gifts coming out and you shining and blossoming, this world will not be as bright a place as it should be. So you have to know you are a person of destiny. God has an assignment for you. You're not here by accident. You've been handpicked by the Creator of the universe to be here in 2024. There is a calling on your life. But I know sometimes what you know, kind of gets us off course is we get disappointed and we have some, you know, some bad breaks or things don't turn out like we thought. But you know, one principle we can see in the resurrection that on Friday, it didn't look good. On Friday, Jesus was defeated. On Friday, you got all these problems. He's being crucified and everybody's saying, well, too bad. He must not have been the Messiah. But you have to remind yourself on Friday that Sunday is coming, that there is a resurrection that, you know, really, I think one lesson is even when it looks like it's over, it's still not over. God has the final say. We're all gonna have some Fridays in life, but you gotta remember in your Fridays, God, you're still on the throne. You are still in control. Let me tell you, all the forces of darkness cannot stop what God has purposed for your life. Here's the way to think about it. The enemy cannot stop you. Other people cannot stop you. But do you know who can stop you? You. You can stop yourself. Negative, defeated, you know, of course, with bad decisions. But I think a lot of times it's just that limited mentality. Well, I'm stuck here. Or I've made too many mistakes, or I don't come from the right family. You got to tune all that out. God being for you is more than the world being against you. God is breathing in your direction right now. Come on, if God can raise Jesus from the dead, He can turn your situation around. God can bring dead things back to life. I'm simply saying, let's be believers and not doubters. Let me tell you, 2024 is not going to be an average year. It's going to be a blessed year, a productive year, a year where you see God do some uncommon, unusual things, a supernatural year. You stay in faith and you're going to come to December 31st, 2024 and look back and say, look what the Lord has done. God has been good in my life. I've seen some resurrection, some favor, some blessings, some breakthroughs in Jesus' name. We're going to take a moment to pray today individually. So if you guys here in the auditorium, if you have anything you'd like for us to stand in agreement with, there'll be a prayer partner at the front of your section, up top, all over the building. Somebody would love to pray for you during this next song. Anyone's welcome to come down for prayer. Rest of you, you're welcome to be seated if you'd like. And our friends watching online, listening live on Sirius XM, thanks so much for being with us. And my sister Lisa is there to pray for you as well. But God bless you today.
Good morning, good morning. We are so glad you have joined us to celebrate Easter here at Lakewood Church. Welcome, welcome, welcome. And today, as my brother said, we are celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I think about how after Jesus died, that the ladies went to the tomb to take care of his body. But when they got there, they saw that the stone was rolled away. The tomb was empty, and angels appeared to them and said, "Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, he is risen." And he has risen indeed. And because of Jesus, because he is risen, we can have forgiveness of sins, we can have healing in our bodies, healing in our minds, and we can live a life of victory. You know what? Because he lives, we can go boldly to the throne of grace to find help and mercy in the time of need. And that's what we're going to do. As we're praying in the sanctuary, I want to pray for you. I want to pray for your family and the needs that you have. But before we do, can I share a praise report with you, a couple of praise reports with you? Let this encourage you, because we pray all the time, but know that God is always working on your behalf. We'd love to hear your praise reports, what God has done. And we heard from Isaac, and he said that his dad beat cancer, and we are so happy for your dad, Isaac. We are going to be praying for your family and for others who are facing cancer and other diseases, other sicknesses. Maybe it's migraines. I don't know what it is, but God is your healer. Then Patty received a promotion and a pay raise at her workplace. And Patty, we are so very happy for you. We just believe God is going to continue to bless you. And I want to start by praying for those who are sick in their bodies. You know, the Bible says that by the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. It says that when we worship Him, that He will remove sickness from the midst of us. So wherever you are, if you can right now, place your hand on the part of your body that is hurting or is sick. And I'm going to pray for you now. Father, in Jesus' name, I thank you for the anointing of healing right now that is flowing through your people all over the world. I thank you that you are healing them, that you are driving out sickness, pain, Father. You are driving out headaches, migraines in the name of Jesus. I thank you that cancer is disappearing from people even right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, I thank you that you're restoring health to them. You're giving them energy. They're going to live a long, healthy life. They're going to glorify you, and they're going to fulfill every day that you have called them to have. Every day, every plan, Father, that you call them to fulfill, they will fulfill it. In the name of Jesus, you be encouraged and be strengthened. Amen and amen. I do want to pray for your family also, because I know there are many needs. There's a lot of families you need reconciliation. You need restoration. People aren't talking to each other, and God needs to work in your life. Some of you just need unity in your family. Some of you are believing God for a loved one that is away from God. Don't ever give up praying for them, because they will come into the kingdom of God. I know that Steve asked us to pray for his two kids to have healthy friendships, and we're going to pray about that. That's so important, to have good friendships. That's something I prayed for my children a lot, that God would connect them with the right people. Brenda, we need to pray for her brother, Carlos, to overcome a smoking addiction. Any addiction you may be facing right now, did you know that God can set you free? Maybe you've tried and tried on your own, but you know, there comes a time we just say, God, I can't do it anymore. I need you to help me. And that's when the Holy Spirit comes in and gives you the grace to overcome, and you don't have to do it on your own. You can do it with the help of the Holy Spirit. So Father, I just lay my hands on this card that represents all the families all over the world. Father, I thank you for bringing healing, restoration, reconciliation. I thank you, Father, that all strife and all conflict are going to be resolved. And Father, you're bringing such a sweet unity, a sweet peace into these families, and they will not only be restored, but they will serve you together all the days of their lives. Thank you, Father, for touching Brenda's brother, Carlos, and delivering him, giving him complete freedom from this addiction in Jesus' name. I thank you, Father, that you will bring your people good, healthy, strong relationships, people who are there to encourage them. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you for it. And we bless these families. Thank you that your hand is upon them, Father. Your favor is upon them. And they will be blessed, and they will walk in peace. Great peace have those who love your word, Father. And I thank you that they will have great peace. Take hold of that word today. You'll have great peace in your life. You'll have great peace in your family. You may be thinking, well, there's not much peace in my home. Well, start declaring that. Take hold of what God said. There will be great peace in your home. You may need to walk around your home a little bit by yourself and start declaring there will be great peace in your home in Jesus' name. And before the time runs out, let me pray. Let me pray for those who are struggling in your mental health. Willis, for his daughter who's struggling with panic attacks. Angie has anxiety and depression. You know, the Bible says that Jesus wore our griefs and our sorrows, and the chastisement that brought us peace was upon him. And so that peace of mind that we need, Father, in the name of Jesus, I pray for Willis's daughter, for Angie. Father, I thank you for your peace that passes all understanding. that will flood their hearts, their minds, their bodies, their soul right now, that you will heal their soul, you'll restore their soul, and you'll bring peace upon them in the name of Jesus. I thank you that they're not going to walk all their days in anxiety or depression, because you're setting them free right now in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. You know, I struggle with anxiety myself, but I'm telling you, God was faithful to deliver me, and He's faithful to deliver you. Well, God bless you. Let's go back into the service.
Jesus has done the impossible, hasn't He? He defeated death. The Bible says that He took the keys of death, hell, and the grave, and He did what He said He was going to do. But what I want to do is give our attention to what happened immediately following Jesus' resurrection. I think it's really important to see what Jesus would do next. You see, the Bible unpacks that He would appear first to the disciples who have gathered, then days later, He would appear again. Because the first time, Thomas was absent, and Jesus has a message to communicate to Thomas. In fact, both accounts, Jesus does the same thing. He relays a message to His disciples that I believe extends to us today. He says to them first, "Peace be with you." And then He does something powerful. He shows them His scars. He shows them His scars on His side, and He shows the scars on His hands. As if to say, "Look, guys, it's me. Yes, Friday happened, but death couldn't stop me. The enemy did not win. God's power has resurrected me." Oh, church, this is powerful to me. And the reason why this is powerful to me is because God rose Him from the dead, and He could have made His hands perfect, but He left scars. I believe that He left the scars to possibly show us, to show you, to show me that, yes, people may betray you. You may get hurt. You may face some hardships, but in Jesus, you can be healed. In Jesus, you can overcome things. Friends, like Jesus, your scars tell a story. Yes, you've been hurt. Yes, you've been through some stuff. But more importantly, they say that you've been healed. They say that you've come through some things. They speak that you've met a redeemer, that you've met a healer, that you've met a restorer. The promise of resurrection is that God can turn any pain into purpose, that He can redeem us, that He can redeem every hurt, every setback, and that He turns around all those things for our good. Friends, the resurrection tells us that we can overcome any obstacle. You don't have to get stuck. You can move forward. You see, for the disciples, for the early followers, it's easy to put a period at the tomb, to think that it's over. It's easy for you and I to put a period on our pain and to think it's over. This is where it all ends. Oh, but the resurrection is our hope that God is not done, that Jesus can do the impossible. What did Jesus do with His scars? He used them as a testimony of the healing and the resurrection power of His Father, who brought that which was dead back to life. And the Bible says the same Spirit. Everybody say, the same Spirit. The same Spirit that rose Christ from the dead lives on the inside of you today. That's powerful. You are a powerful person. So what does that ultimately mean? Because of the resurrection of Jesus, all pain, all hurt, it all can be redeemed for your good and for His purpose. Watch this.
All right, let's go to El Paso, Texas. Check in with Sherry next. Hello, Sherry. You're on with Victoria.
My daughter was in a car accident. She was a passenger in a car 5 years ago. It's a parent's worst nightmare to get that phone call, but we got the phone call.
I was a principal of an elementary school, and I was just fixing to pull out of the parking lot. And on my phone, it said UMC, which is a hospital in El Paso. So I answered, and it was a lady, and she said, ma'am, you need to get here now.
Babe, I just got a call. The hospital. I think it's bad. We got to get there now. You know, when you walk into the hospital and there's all the people sitting in the emergency room waiting for their loved ones, and the doctor or the nurse or whoever tells you, follow me, and they put you in a small room, you know it's probably not going to be, hey, she broke her ankle, or you're ready.
We instantly started praying. We started calling everyone. We need you praying. And that's hard to do when someone's telling you she's not okay. Your daughter's not okay, and this isn't gonna be okay. And it's really, really hard to do when they're telling you she's not gonna live through the night.
Both of the sides of her skull removed on both sides to relieve the pressure from her accident where, you know, her brain had swollen against the skull. And I saw her, and, you know, at the time she was unresponsive, just laying in a bed. She was not there at all.
They told us that Jacqueline, if she does wake up, she will never be the same. She will never walk again. She will never talk again. She will never be able to eat again. I said, Father, God, you love my daughter more than I do. And I know that. And as a parent, I can't do this.
I looked at my son, I said, this is the worst day ever. And he said, no, Dad, this is the greatest day. God didn't choose to take Jacqueline. He left her here.
Lakewood was an inspiration to us while we were in the hospital here in Houston with Jacqueline. Joel helped get us through what we needed to hear. He gave us exactly what we needed to hear at the right time.
Now, you may not see how your situation could ever change, how God could reverse the trouble. Doesn't look possible in the natural. But God is supernatural. He has ways that we've never thought of. Be a believer and not a doubter.
We really chose to just move forward and live each and every day to its fullest potential and know that God was in control.
Mr. Pellicott would, you know, once in a while send me pictures. You know, one day he would send me a picture of her like sitting, and she's like, he would be like, oh, Jacqueline's sitting today. And then he had like his hand by her, like, you know, kind of holding her up. I'm like, yeah, sure. You're like holding her up, you know?
But when I really knew that she was back, because I hadn't heard her voice for 10 months. And I remember we had put her in bed. We were home at this point, but we heard her rustling around, and I went in there and I said, are you okay? And she does this. And I said, do you need anything? And she puts her thumb down. And I said, okay, Jack, well, I love you. And she looked at me and she whispered, I love you too. And I started screaming. It's like 2 a.m. Woke up Dennis and Jacob, our son, and they're like, what's wrong? What's wrong? I'm like, she's talking.
There's no way I thought Jacqueline would make that leap. And she already has. And she's already exceeded all my expectations for her. From where she was to where she is now, it's amazing.
God brought me back to life and gave me another chance at life. And I knew that I'm not gonna just always be sad about where I am right now, but God has led us the entire way and is still doing so today.
We've never said we hope. We've always believed that when Jacqueline walks again, when Jacqueline talks again, when Jacqueline can eat again, that's what we say.
We celebrate a miracle. God is still in the miracle working business. This is all because of the God in you, the God that the resurrection power that lives in you, that got you and your beautiful mom and dad and brother through it all. Tell us a little bit about.
Well, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but God said, not today, Satan, not today. God has done so much for us and continues to do. Never did I think in a million years I would be on this stage right now with such an amazing lady. So thank you for having us. I have so many scars, and none of them are visible except this one. And every time someone sees me, they say, "What happened?" I say, "Well, you might want to take a seat. This is a very long story."
Well, you know, when I spoke to you earlier, several months ago, you know, one thing that struck me about you, Jacqueline, was your joy. Tell me about the joy that lives inside of you, because it's an inspiration to us all. We may never go through what you did, but sometimes we're quick to lose our joy. But God has blessed you with this joy.
God has done so much, and I wake up every morning, I talk to God, and I ask Him, "What are you going to do with me today? How am I going to serve you?" And everything He does is absolutely amazing. I have a foundation, and we go and give money to patients who have a traumatic brain injury like I had, and that's such a blessing to give back to others. So I say how such a tragedy turned into such a huge blessing. Definitely.
So tell us what you're doing right now. Besides your foundation, I know you go and you speak to other, young nurses and families. Tell us what else you're doing.
So a couple years ago, I decided I want to go back to college. I'm going to start off with one class, take it easy. And I tell my parents, I'm taking calculus. They look at me and say, "Jacqueline, you have a brain injury. It's going to be very hard." I said, "I got it." So I would pray and just give it to God. And my first class back in college, I got an A in calculus. So now I'm back in school full time to be a neuropsychologist. Plus, I've seen my brain, so it's pretty, very interesting.
That is beautiful. We just stand in amazement and in awe and inspiration of you.
Thank you.
I want to ask you, Dennis, looking at your beautiful daughter, being a father, what is your feeling today?
You asked me that in the first service. You tried to get me to cry, and I know you're trying to do it again. You know, God has been so good to us. You know, I stand here and I look at every single one of you, and I want you to listen. God is amazing. The doctor that spoke on the video was the plastic surgeon, and Jacqueline said, "Dad, I need to go to the plastic surgeon and get my scars taken care of." I said, "Why, Jacqueline?" Jesus showed His scars. If He could rise from the dead, He could have closed His scars. No. Look at the stories that came from it. We turned Jacqueline's story into an wow. Everybody we share our story with, and believe me, we know everybody in here has a story, and we pray for everybody that is in a journey right now. We were chosen to give our story today with this beautiful family on this stage and share with you. Everybody was put here today together to listen to this story because you need to hear it. God is here for you as He is here for us. So what do I have to say about my daughter? Wow, I am so proud of her. Thank you.
Sherry, this was a long road. We're standing here rejoicing, but this was a long road. And as a mother, I know that you were continually stirring your faith. Tell us a little bit about how did you stay so strong?
I think for me as a mom, as a parent, I chose to give Jacqueline to God that day because I knew I couldn't do it, but I knew He could. And so I decided right then and there, I'm going to stand strong with God, and I'm going to trust His word, and I'm going to read His word, and I'm going to stand in faith. And even in the storm and the hardest times, Jacqueline's had 16 surgeries. So every time we'd go into surgery, we'd take two steps forward and then we'd take two steps back. And Joel has said this before, when you're in the storm, it's not easy. It's not an easy thing to do. But when you praise God every step of the way and you thank Him and you just give Him the glory, He gives you that peace. And it's just amazing.
Wow. Well, we celebrate this family today. Jacqueline, what an inspiration you are. And you know, there are hard times and storms, and there are valleys. But I just want to encourage you. You may be going through a valley, maybe not like this, but it is a valley. And I want to tell you, just like Jacqueline, you may be going through some tough things, but you're not going to stay there. The God of all hope is going to carry you through the valley, back to the mountaintop. So put your hope in Him.
And bring you back even better.
Bring you back even better with more purpose, more destiny. You heard it from the lips of a miracle right here. Let's stand in agreement all together and pray for our congregation. Father, I thank You. I thank You, Father, that they are full of hope today. That, Father, this family being such an inspiration, Father, showing Your strength in them, Your healing in them, Your deliverance in them. Let us all, Father, keep that joy. Keep those memorial stones before us. Keep the good report in front of us. And so, Father, we thank You that You not only brought Jacqueline out of this stronger with more purpose, but You're going to bring every one of us out of it. Father, You're going to help us all along the way because You are God, You're King of Kings, You're Lord of Lords, and we declare we have the resurrection power living on the inside of us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
God knows how to bring beauty for ashes. We believe He's working all things together for your good. Thanks so much for being with us on this Resurrection Sunday. Honored to have you. Let's take a moment to worship the Lord with our tithes and our offerings. We want to thank you so much for your generosity and your donations. You know this, but you're impacting people all over the world. The scripture says in Proverbs, when you refresh others, you will be refreshed. Well, that's what you do every week as you give and support the ministry. You are refreshing people. We just believe God's going to refresh you in new ways and just give you the ideas, the creativity, the open doors. Remember, our job is not our source. God is our source. The scripture says promotion doesn't come from the north, the south, the east, or the west, but promotion comes from the Lord. So know that you're honoring Him. I believe He's going to do some things that you can't do. Last thing, when you give, give in faith. Not just, let me just throw something in, let me just do something online. No, when you give, you are worshiping God with your giving. So give in faith, knowing that you serve a good God. I believe He's going to refresh you in new ways, that 2024 is going to be a bountiful year in your life.
Greetings, Lakewood, and happy Easter. I am here in Warsaw, Poland, visiting one of our partners, Word of Faith Ministries. They do an amazing work here to help take care of refugees, orphans, and others, providing for their daily needs, spiritually and physically. It's because of you that we're able to partner with organizations like these all over the world. Lakewood Church is making a difference in bringing hope to the four corners of the world, and it all happens because of you, because of your faithfulness, because of your prayers. Because of you, you're here with us in each and every place that we make an impact. So thank you so much, and God bless you for all that you do.
I am here in Ukraine, and we are here at the Help Center, where they are bringing in special needs families that are displaced from battle zones. And they bring them here to live, and they feed them. But many of these families need services. And in this Help Center, there will be the first Champions Club for special needs in Ukraine. Where over 600 special needs children live in just in this area. And they're gonna be developed just like every other child. They're gonna have physical therapy. They're going to have sensory. They're going to have educational. And mostly they're gonna have spiritual development and become everything God's created them to be. We are so excited. This is something that you're a part of. And we just wanna thank you, Lakewood Church, for what you're going to do right here in this city. It's going to make a difference. It's changing the world.
Hi, Lakewood family. Greetings from Northwest Province of Zambia, where I'm working at Mukingi Mission Hospital. I've been here almost a week now, and I'll be here almost 4 months. First week's been very busy. We've had a lot of people who are very sick, people who are injured in car accidents and motorbike accidents. But by God's grace, everyone is doing well. I just wanted to say on this Easter, thank you for what you're doing to help suffering people around the world. Your giving is making a difference. God bless you and happy Easter.
We can't thank you enough. We are so proud of our Lakewood family. It is your faithfulness to give that has enabled us to be the hands and feet of Jesus across this city, this nation, and around the world.
We do appreciate you. I want to speak a blessing over our giving today. Lord, thank you for all the generous givers here in the room and all across the world. Lord, you see their sacrifices and their faithfulness. Lord, as they're refreshing others, I thank you that you will do what you promised, that you will refresh them. Lord, let their gifts and talents come out to the full. I thank you for a new level of courage and of faith and favor. Lord, ideas and creativity. Lord, bring contracts and opportunities to them. Lord, do what they can't do. Lord, you've done it before, but I know you'll do it again. I pray for those that are struggling in their finances, Lord, that you would show them a sign of your favor, even this week. Lord, we love you today, and we give it in Jesus' name. God bless you today as you give.
Here are some ways you can give. Scan the QR code using your smartphone. Text Give Hope to 77977. Go online to lakewoodchurch.com/give. Or call us toll-free at 888-567-JOEL. Your giving is changing lives in our city and all over the world.
When Jesus died, it got dark. Quite literally, the Bible says that the sun's light failed. But it wasn't just physically dark, it was dark in the hearts of the hopeful. Jesus had died, and it seemed like hope was lost. It seemed like we were out of options for a hero. But now, we all watch the sun rise. Not the S-U-N, because we know that the sun will still rise in the east and set in the west. But oh, on that third day, we'd watch the S-O-N get up and restore the light of hope to all who believe that he was the Messiah. He's the one who was sent to save. So I'll ask you the same question that was asked to the women who went to look for Jesus at the tomb. Why do you look for the living among the dead? Why is it that we look for Jesus in the wrong places? Why do we look in the grave when we should look in the sky? Why look low when we should look up? See, Jesus isn't dead and dormant. Jesus is alive and active because he rose. He's forever on the throne. Because he rose, he's worthy of the honor. Because he rose, he's worthy of the praise. Because he got up, you can get up from whatever it is that has held you down, whatever has seemed to be your end. Because he rose, you can overcome the addiction. Because he rose, you can be healed. Because he rose, you don't walk alone. Because he rose, he's the living Lord. So watch the sun rise into glory. Watch the sun rise into victory, because he established his position for eternity. Death was not the end for Jesus. That's not how the story ends. It's no longer dark. It's no longer hopeless. The light of the world is here to stay. He's hope. He's life. And because he rose on that day, forever he will reign.
Hallelujah.
you tell our kids choir, our young people over here, how much you love them? Love you guys, our choir, our band, worship team. Come on, let's all sing together one last time, if you don't mind. And can I tell you again how honored we are to have you here at Lakewood on a Resurrection Sunday? We love you guys. And I really believe the service is better because you took time to come out. You brought God with you. You brought joy with you. You brought victory with you. That person on your left and on your right, they are VIPs. You be good to them. They're full of God, the favor of God. And we just welcome you all. And hey, if you're visiting, very honored to have you. I know I can't meet everybody, but I'm in the lobby after the service, after every service. And so love to shake your hand if you have a moment, but come back and be with us whenever you can. We're this wild every Sunday, not just on Easter service, but we'd love to have you back. And let me tell you this, here's what I know. Your life goes better when you put God first place. And I know on Sundays, you know, everybody's busy, you can run in errands, you know, it could be a day off, but look at you today. You say, God, I'm gonna go to the house of the Lord. Let me tell you, you can't give God something without him giving you more back in return. And I know we don't go to just give, we go to worship, but it's just the way God is. So the scripture puts it this way, stay planted in the house of the Lord and you will flourish. Very honored to have you here. Hey, if you've never been baptized in water, this coming Saturday, I'm gonna be baptizing people, and I would be honored to baptize you. Or maybe you have children that have never been baptized. If they're old enough to know they're born again, well, it's the first command of the Lord Jesus. Baptize about 1,000 people every time we do it. Love to have you come out. You can sign up online and we'll tell you when to come. You won't have to wait so long, but just blessed to have you here. Jacqueline, I love your story over here. Isn't that amazing what God can do? And, you know, God is supernatural, but you know what? It takes people to step into it. And I love what this family did, because you know, you can get bitter in those times. You can, you know, turn away from God, but that's when you turn to your faith and look what God can do. We serve an awesome God. Anyway, great to have you here. What do we have, y'all? Next Sunday, we have For King and Country. You know, got those guys, 4 Grammy Awards and just a great group. They're gonna be here, those two brothers. And what else we got? I got a homecoming weekend, y'all. And if you don't live here, I'm talking to the guys that are watching now, but April 13th and 14th, you've never been to Lakewood. You've never met any of these people. Come on out April 13th and 14th, and we'll make you feel right at home. We'd love to meet you here on that homecoming weekend. We got a little calendar for you when you leave, or if you haven't got one, because he rose. Johnny, I'm gonna give that to you. Johnny, my friend, is his birthday today on Easter Sunday. Hey, Johnny! Johnny, you look good for 61 years old. I'm sorry you can't jump like I can still, though, but Johnny's a good man. All right, when you see yourself on the big screen, can you give our TV audience a great big Lakewood welcome? God bless you. It's great to be with you today, and I hope you stay connected with us during the week through our daily podcast, our YouTube channel, social media, and you can come visit us in person. We'd love to have you be a part of one of our services. I'd like to start with something funny, and in Texas, we're known for everything being bigger. There was this Texan farmer that loved to brag about the size of his ranch. He was in England and met this English farmer. He asked him how big his ranch was, knowing that he'd probably ask about his. The Englishman said, "My ranch is 35 acres. How big is yours?" The Texan said, "Well, let's just put it this way. If I got in my truck at sunrise and started driving across my property, at sunset, I would still be on my ranch." The Englishman said, "Yeah, I used to have a truck like that." No bragging around here. Here we go, y'all. This is my Bible. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do what it says I can do. Today, I will be taught the Word of God. I boldly confess. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I will never be the same. I'm about to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I'll never be the same. Never, never, never. I'll never be the same in Jesus' name. God bless you. If you'd like to open your Bibles to Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10, you're welcome to. We'll put the scriptures on the screen as well. Don't forget, at 2 o'clock, we have the whole service, but it's all in Spanish. We have an amazing Spanish team. Monday night, we have a Bible study online. Wednesday night, still online. Plus Wednesday night, our junior high and our youth meet out in the other building. Thursday, our college students meet as well, but have something for every part of the family. So we had several thousand kids here yesterday for our Spring Fest too. We had a great time, but just again, honored to have you today. I want to talk to you today about grace for Gethsemane. The word Gethsemane means a place of pressing. It was an olive garden in Jerusalem. Workers would put olives into a press. They were squeezed, and under that pressure, the oil would come out. You couldn't have the valuable olive oil without the pressing. It's not a coincidence that before Jesus went to the cross, before he rose from the dead, he had to go through the Garden of Gethsemane. That's where he was so overwhelmed and so distressed, knowing what he was about to face, that he sweat great drops of blood. He said, "My soul is in agony, even to the point of death." He had this season of suffering that he had to endure. He could have given up, said, "Father, I'm done here. This is too much." He could have called angels to come rescue him, but he made this decision, "Father, not my will, but your will be done." He passed the test. We celebrate the resurrection, but the real victory was won in Gethsemane. That's where he refused to give up. He didn't get bitter because people betrayed him, didn't get discouraged because disciples fell asleep, didn't live frustrated because the plan wasn't fair. He was squeezed, he was pressured, he was uncomfortable, but he endured the suffering knowing that the joy that was coming. Real victory is not won in public, it's won in private. It's what you do in Gethsemane when you're taking the treatment, the child's off course, when your dream is delayed. Paul said in Philippians, "I want to know him in the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his suffering." You can't have a resurrection without some suffering. You have to have a strong will, a made-up mind, not a weak mentality, but a warrior mentality. "I am in this for the long haul. I will not give up, start complaining, blaming, doubting. I know on the other side of this suffering is the power of the resurrection. There's healing, there's abundance, there are divine connections, there are new levels." Peter said, "After you have suffered a little while, you will come out established." The suffering is not permanent. The squeezing, the pressing is not how your story ends. Gethsemane is just one stop. It's just a season. It's designed for you to pass through it so you can come into the power, the fullness, the abundance that God has in store. But the enemy would love for us to get stuck in Gethsemane. Why did this door close? Why is this taking so long? Why did my child get off course? You can't reach your destiny without being pressured, squeezed, thoughts telling you that it's never going to work out. God has forgotten about you. The fact that you feel the pressure, that's a sign that a resurrection is coming. You wouldn't be in Gethsemane if you weren't close to something amazing. Not ordinary, but supernatural. Doors opening you never dreamed would open. Business tracking you down. The right people showing up, healing from what looks impossible. When you're in a place of pressing, don't let it squeeze your faith out, squeeze your hope, squeeze your dreams. Turn it around and let it squeeze the doubt out. "God, I don't see a way, but I know you're making a way." Squeeze the bitterness out. "God, they hurt me, but I know you're my vindicator." Squeeze the discouragement out. "I lost this loved one, but God, I know you have beauty for these ashes." I can't promise you that you'll never have a Gethsemane, never feel pressured, overwhelmed, betrayed, but I can promise you there is grace for every Gethsemane. The Apostle Paul had what he called a thorn in his flesh, something that he couldn't get rid of. 3 times he prayed, "God, take this away. Get me out of Gethsemane. I'm uncomfortable." He couldn't pray it away. God said, "Paul, my grace is sufficient for you." God won't let you go into that pressure without giving you what you need to handle it. Quit telling yourself, "I can't take this anymore. Joel, I can't raise these kids. I can't deal with this sickness. These coworkers are driving me crazy." You're defeating yourself. When you're being squeezed, you have to talk to yourself the right way. I can handle this. I am strong in the Lord. I can do all things through Christ. In one sense, it was easy for Jesus to heal the blind man, easy to turn water into wine, easy to raise Lazarus from the dead. But now Jesus was in Gethsemane. He was so distressed that he fell to the ground, overwhelmed by pressure. You don't get to choose the road you travel. Sometimes God will take you to a Gethsemane, down a path that's uncomfortable. There's pressure, adversity. You didn't choose it. We like the favor, the blessing, the good times. This battle chose you. And Jesus already knew the outcome. He already knew he would rise again, be seated next to his Father. He knew the end, but in the middle, the pressure was so great, he still questioned. He said, "Father, if you're willing, take this bitter cup from me." 3 times he prayed that, but the heavens were silent. God never answered. He didn't hear a voice boom out like when he was being baptized. "Son, I'm pleased with you. Keep going strong. It's all going to work out." He heard from his Father in the good times, but in Gethsemane, the most difficult time in his life, not a word. But God being silent doesn't mean that he's not there. That's a test. That's when you have to show God you're going to trust him even when you don't hear him. You're going to keep believing even though nothing is changing. When heaven is silent, you need to go back to what God already promised you. "God, I'm in Gethsemane dealing with this illness, but Lord, you said you're Jehovah Rapha, the Lord my healer. Lord, I thank you, you're restoring health back into me. God, I'm suffering from this child that's breaking my heart. But God, you said, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. God, I feel overwhelmed with this situation at work. These people have done me wrong, but God, I know you're my vindicator. You said many are the afflictions of the righteous, but you deliver me out of them all." Jesus said, "Father, if you can, take this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but let your will be done." It's okay to ask God to take something away, but you need to add the nevertheless. "God, if it doesn't happen my way, I'm not going to complain, live bitter, give up on my dreams. I'm going to stand strong, endure, knowing that this suffering season is leading to a resurrection, to a new level of my destiny." God wouldn't have let you go to Gethsemane if he didn't have something amazing in front of you. There are levels of favor and blessing you can only see by going through a season of pressing, a season of suffering. Gethsemane is not the enemy. It's designed by God. It's a strategic place to launch you to the power of the resurrection, to see favor that you've never imagined. But here's the key. Before you see public victory, you have to win the private victory. Before you see your resurrection, you have to pass the test in Gethsemane. Had Jesus said, "Father, take this bitter cup from me because I'm bitter. I'm not putting up with this suffering. It's too much." He wouldn't have seen the resurrection. He wouldn't be seated on the right hand of the Father. Are you missing favor, increase, because you're stuck in Gethsemane? Bitter over what didn't work out, upset over the door that closed, angry over who left you? Try a different approach. If you win the battle in Gethsemane, pass that test, you will see what God is up to. This is not the time to be sour. This is the time to say, "I may not like it, but God, I trust you. I know your plans for me are for good. You wouldn't have brought me into Gethsemane if I wasn't on the verge of a resurrection, a breakthrough, a new level of my destiny." When Jesus prayed that third time, the scripture says angels came and strengthened him. When you have an attitude of faith in times of suffering, you don't complain in the pressing, you're trusting God when the heavens are silent, when you're squeezed, instead of being sour, you're thanking him that he's working, that's when angels are going to show up. You'll feel a supernatural strength to endure when you should be overwhelmed, a power to keep moving forward when you should be stuck, a courage to believe when you should be doubting.
That's how you pass the test. You can't pray away Gethsemane. Jesus asked his Father to remove this bitter cup. Father, get me out of this suffering, this pressure. God didn't say, all right, I'll remove it. I'll change my plan. Gethsemane is a setup. That suffering is leading to a resurrection, to something supernatural. We see this in the life of David, 17 years old, a teenager out taking care of his father's sheep, when the prophet Samuel showed up and chose him over all of his brothers as the next king of Israel, a destiny moment. David heard Goliath taunting the Israelites. They were all afraid. He went out with a slingshot and a few stones and defeated this giant. Overnight, he became a national hero, another destiny moment. He was invited by King Saul to come to the palace and serve as his armor bearer. He went from no one knowing him to this influential position, the favor of God. Everything was going great, one good break after another. Then King Saul became jealous of David, tried to kill him. Here David was honoring Saul, being his best, but David came in to a Gethsemane, a time of pressing, a time of squeezing. He had to flee for his life. He lived out in the desert, in caves, in hiding, on the run. It wasn't fair. He hadn't done anything wrong. David could have become bitter. God, where are you? Why'd you let this happen? But he understood this principle that the suffering was a setup. It was a sign that a resurrection was coming. David kept doing the right thing. At one point, he could have killed Saul. He and his men snuck up on Saul while he was sleeping. David wouldn't do it. He knew God had anointed Saul. He wouldn't touch him. Even though David was suffering, he took the high road and did the right thing. It wasn't long after that that Saul was killed in a battle and David was made king. On the way to your destiny, there will be these moments of favor, God opening doors, bringing right people, causing to excel. But there will also be some Gethsemanes, some times of pressing, squeezing. How you handle Gethsemane will determine whether you get stuck there or whether you come into the resurrection. It's easy to get bitter when people do us wrong, upset over the medical report, sour over the contract that we lost. But when you understand Gethsemane is strategic, it's necessary for you to go to the next level. You can't have a resurrection without a Gethsemane. You have to pass the test. Here's the key, in the pressure. Any of us can do the right thing when it's easy. When Samuel's anointing us, when we're defeating Goliath, when Saul's calling us into the palace, we all have a good attitude, song of praise, we give our best. That doesn't take much faith. The test comes when it's not fair, when people betrayed you, the medical report's not good, business went down, you're in Gethsemane. That's when many people give up, blame God, I can't take this pressure. Don't get stuck in Gethsemane. It was never designed to be permanent. For you to live there, it's a temporary season. If you'll pass the test in private, then you'll come into public victory. We celebrate Jesus rising from the dead, but without Gethsemane, without that private victory, we wouldn't be celebrating. And sometimes we're waiting for God to change things. Joel, when I get through this suffering, then I'll have a good attitude. When the pressure is not so much, when these people quit doing me wrong, God, if you'll take this bitter cup from me, then I'll start believing again. No, add the second part of the prayer. Nevertheless, not my will, but let your will be done. You're saying, God, I know your grace is sufficient. So I'm going to keep being my best right where I am. I'm going to have a smile when I could be discouraged. I'm going to have a song of praise when I could be complaining. I'm going to keep thanking you that things are turning in my favor when I don't see any sign of it. God, I'm going to be good to people who are not being good to me. When you know God in the fellowship of his suffering, like the scripture says, then you're going to know him in the power of his resurrection. You may be in Gethsemane now. God's been good to you. You've seen his blessing. but you're in a time of pressing, squeezing. It's uncomfortable. People have come against you, strain in your finances, a child has an illness. You're on a road that you didn't choose, facing things you don't understand. God sees what you're dealing with. He knows who did you wrong, what wasn't fair. When He's not removing the pressure, that means you have the grace to withstand, to endure, to overcome. You may not be able to pray it away, but when you say, God, I trust you. I'm not giving up on my dreams. I'm not backing down on what you promised. I'm gonna stand strong, knowing that you're in control, that this season of suffering is a sign that a resurrection is coming. That's what allows the creator of the universe to go to work. That's when angels are dispatched with healing, favor, and breakthroughs. Don't get stuck in Gethsemane. That's not your destiny. Earlier that evening, Jesus had dinner with the 12 disciples. We call it the Last Supper. He prayed over them, told them what he was going to go through, and washed their feet. He left that night with Peter, James, and John. And they went to the Garden of Gethsemane. Jesus felt so overwhelmed, he asked them to stay up and pray for him. He went over by himself and fell on the ground, prayed that God would take this cup from him if he could. A little while, he went back to check on his disciples, hoping to get some encouragement. He looked over and they were asleep. He woke them up and said, come on, guys, couldn't you stay up for an hour and pray for me? This is the most critical time of my life. He's kind of frustrated. He asked them again, even more emphatically, please stay awake and pray for me. He thought for sure they got the message, and he went off for a little while and prayed and came back a little later. Same thing. They were sound asleep. Sometimes when you need people the most, they're not there for you. There's a temptation to think, man, if I had them, then I could get through this. Then I could overcome. But the fact is, when you're in Gethsemane, it's between you and God. You don't need other people. If someone's always rescuing you, praying for you, keeping you cheered up, that's going to limit your growth. God will wean you away from people so you'll have to depend on Him. He wants to hear your prayer. You have a direct line to Him. He's always listening. Jesus woke the disciples up again and asked them to pray. And he went away and came back the third time. They had fallen asleep. This time, He didn't try to wake them up. He didn't try to convince them to pray. He looked at them and said, sleep on. He came to a point where He didn't let it bother Him anymore. He could have kept waking them up, being frustrated. Instead, He accepted that He wasn't going to have their support, and that was okay. He knew He didn't need them to fulfill His destiny. When things don't turn out the way you thought, friends you were counting on weren't there for you, you didn't get that promotion you deserved, the medical report hasn't improved, you've done all you can, you prayed, you believed, you worked hard. Instead of letting that frustrate you, you need to say like Jesus, tell it to sleep on. You're not going to bother me anymore. I'm not going to try to control things I can't control. I'm not going to lose sleep over who's not supporting me, over what didn't work out. I know God is on the throne. He's fighting my battles. He will get me to where I'm supposed to be. Real victory is not when God does everything you like, changes all the negative circumstances, fixes all the people that get on your nerves. Real victory is when all that happens, but it doesn't bother you anymore. You've grown to the point where you don't have to have all that to be happy. You're content while God is working right where you are, knowing that He's given you grace, not just for the good times, but grace for Gethsemane. When there's pressure, people that fall asleep, doors that don't open, your attitude is, I'm gonna enjoy my life despite what's coming against me. Yes, there's a lot of pressure, but I'm still going to give God praise. Yes, I'm on a road I didn't choose, but I know God is ordering my steps. I wouldn't be in this season of suffering unless a resurrection was coming. Well, Joel, I'm disappointed because these people weren't there for me. They let me down. People can't stop your purpose. If they weren't there for you, you didn't need them. If they walked away, they weren't a part of your destiny. If they were supposed to be there, they couldn't leave. If they weren't supposed to, they couldn't stay. Quit begging them to come back. Tell them to sleep on. God has someone better for you, someone that you can't get rid of, someone that loves you, that admires you, that sees you as the gift from God that you are. That promotion you didn't get, how long are you going to be sour over that? Tell it to sleep on. It's a test. God has a better position. That medical report that hasn't changed, you've done all you can. Quit worrying. Quit living frustrated. Tell it to sleep on. One of the best things I've learned is to not fight everything I don't like. Fight the closed doors. Fight the person that did you wrong. Fight the delays. We end up living in a fighting mode where we're always frustrated. Two words can save you a lot of heartache. Sleep on. God, you're in control. I'm going to do my best and trust you to get me to where I'm supposed to be. After the third time Jesus found his disciples asleep, something rose up in him. He said, we have to leave right now. My time has come. They walked out of the garden and there was Judas looking for him. The principle is you can't stay in Gethsemane and reach your destiny. It's a place that you're supposed to pass through. At some point, you have to rise up and say like Jesus, I'm done being bitter over who left me. I'm done living upset over what I didn't get, angry over the company that hurt me, disappointed by who fell asleep, sour over this road that I didn't choose. I'm leaving excuses, leaving frustration, leaving self-pity, leaving guilt. You have to get out of Gethsemane. Enemy would love for you to get stuck there, stuck in blame, stuck in who hurt you, stuck in a bad childhood. This is a new day. Yes, it was hard. Yes, they fell asleep. They betrayed you. You're on a road you didn't choose. Can I tell you, none of that stopped your destiny. All Gethsemane did was get you prepared for the next level. That pressure caused you to develop more muscles, greater trust, greater faith, greater resilience. The enemy thought it would squeeze your faith out, but it backfired. It squeezed out the doubt, the bitterness, the uncertainty. Now you're stronger, bolder, ready for the new things God has in store. You went through the suffering. Now you're prepared for the power of the resurrection. I can imagine when Satan saw Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, his hands in his face, great distress, sweating drops of blood, saying, Father, take this bitter cup from me. He thought he'd won. Looked like a picture of defeat, like Jesus was giving up. But don't judge the rest of your life by a season in Gethsemane. God wouldn't have let you go in if he wasn't going to bring you out better. He's up to something. The next morning, Jesus went to the cross. And they crucified him. Looked like it was over, but on the third day, he came out of the grave. He said, I am he that lives. I was dead. Behold, I'm alive forevermore. All that suffering was a setup for a resurrection. That time of distress in the garden, that place of pressure, it wasn't random. It wasn't just a bad break. It was all a part of God's plan that would launch Jesus into his purpose. Early that Sunday morning, Mary Magdalene rushed to the tomb to check on Jesus. The stone had been rolled away, but Jesus wasn't there. As she was weeping and confused, wondering who took his body, she heard a voice asking, why are you crying? Who are you looking for? She glanced back and thought it was the gardener. She said, sir, if you've taken him, please tell me where he is. Jesus said to her, Mary. Immediately she recognized him. She went back and told the disciples that he was alive. It's interesting that Jesus was dressed as a gardener. When he arose, he could have dressed as a carpenter, as a rabbi, as a king. But he chose a gardener. Maybe he was showing us the significance of the Garden of Gethsemane. Perhaps he was saying, I made it through my garden, stay in faith. I'm gonna help you make it through yours. The last place Jesus appeared before he ascended to heaven was on the Mount of Olives. That's where Gethsemane is located. A few days earlier, he was there suffering, in agony, great distress. Now he's at that very place, victorious, with the keys of death and hell, not suffering, but reigning, not in agony, but in victory, not great distress, but in all power. Yes, you may go through some Gethsemanes, but like Jesus, you're gonna go back to that very place with great victory, great favor, great courage. The enemy doesn't have the final say, God does. He's ordering your steps. In those times of pressing, keep reminding yourself, it's a setup. That suffering is a sign that a resurrection is coming. Now quit being frustrated over the disappointments, who left you, what you can't control. Tell it to sleep on. You don't need that for your destiny. You keep doing the right thing when it's hard, you are passing the test. God sees your faithfulness. He has angels coming to strengthen you. I believe and declare you're about to see the power of the resurrection. Because you won the victory in private, you're about to see a public victory, favor, promotion, healing, vindication, the fullness of your destiny in Jesus' name. And if you receive it, can you say amen? Let's pray together. If you have 5 minutes, if you can stick with me, we'll just seal it in prayer. Lord, I thank you for what we've heard today. I know it falls on great ground. People, faithful people here at Lakewood, and so many watching and listening. And Lord, we've all been through Gethsemane's. Some are in Gethsemane right now, that pressing and squeezing. And Lord, we're going out of here with a greater trust in you. Lord, we recognize we're not always gonna understand it, but we believe that you're working all things for our good. Lord, we're gonna keep trusting you in the squeezing times. And Lord, I thank you that you're bringing us out better, that you're at work in our lives. And Lord, just let your people step into a new season of your blessing as we celebrate your resurrection. Lord, just new beginnings in all of our lives, fresh joy, fresh favor, fresh signs of your goodness in Jesus' name. With our heads bowed in prayer, just a quick question. If your heart stopped beating in the next few minutes, are you at peace with God? Do you know where you'd spend eternity? If not, I would love to pray with you. I'm not here to condemn anybody. I'm here to help you find a new beginning. I know this comes from a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. In just a moment, if you're not at peace with the Lord, or maybe you are a Christian, but you've grown cold toward God, you know you need to rededicate your life. You need a fresh new start. If that's you, in just a moment, I'm gonna ask you to take a step of faith and stand right where you are, and we're gonna pray together. I can't think of a better time to get on the road to victory than today, Resurrection Sunday. God is not mad at you. Your sins have already been forgiven. All you have to do is accept the free gift of Christ's salvation. Will you do it today? The enemy in your thoughts will whisper, do it next week. Do it another time. Listen, the Bible says, today is the day of salvation. You're not hearing this by accident. But Joel, it's embarrassing to stand in front of everybody. I had people at the house, I can't lift my hand. Listen to what Jesus said. If you won't be ashamed of me before people, then I won't be ashamed of you before my Father in heaven. I'm gonna give you a great opportunity to show God that you're not ashamed of him. If you're not at peace with the Lord, or you just need to rededicate your life, you need a fresh new start, a new beginning. If that's you, would you be bold, take that step of faith, and stand right where you are, and we'll pray together. Would you do that? Come on, Lakewood, let's give them a hand as they stand all over the building. Come on, don't put it off. I feel like there ought to be others. Your heart's beating fast. That's God drawing you. Anybody else? Watching and listening? Come on, Lakewood, they're still standing. Anybody else? Up top? Well, God bless you, and please remain standing if you don't mind. Let me tell you how proud we are of you. I know that took courage to stand, and more importantly, I know the angels are rejoicing in the heavens. God's never going to be ashamed of you because you took this step of faith. And the scripture says that whoever calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Let me help you to call. Do you mind all praying this after me if you would, please? Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins. Come into my heart. I make you my Lord and Savior. Amen. We're going to be standing one more moment. I want to tell you how much we love you, and we're going to be praying for you. I also want to give you a personal invitation and a challenge to come back and be with us on a regular basis. We ask new believers, give us the next year of your life. Make a commitment for the next year. You're going to be here in person, online, on the radio, however you do it. I'll make a promise before that year is over, your life will never be the same for the better. We're going to help you grow and become who God's created you to be. And I think I said it earlier, you know, I know you're busy on Sundays. It may be a day off, but there is a blessing on your life when you get into a community of faith and put God first place. I hope you'll take me up on that offer. After service, there's a room called New Beginnings. If you need anything, stop by. Whenever you get a chance, stop by and give me a chance to shake your hand. Even if you can't do it today, I'm out there any Sunday after I minister. There are classes after service, but know this, the moment you stood up, God washed away all your sins, your mistakes, your failures. You are starting with a fresh, clean slate. Write it down in your Bible, March 31st, 2024, a new day of victory in your life, in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, let's all stand together if you would, please. Thanks so much for coming out today. How many of you are going home better off than you were before? Amen. All right, let me speak the blessing. Until we meet again, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord show you His favor and have mercy on you. And may the Lord watch over you and give you His peace. God bless you. We love you very much. Have a happy Resurrection Sunday and a blessed week. See you back real soon.